Well, yesterday or day before, we have seen different types of electromagnetic waves and their applications. We started with the radio waves, then we have gone for this second type of waves, that is the microwaves. After microwaves, we have seen the infrared waves. After infrared, we have seen the visible radiations. After visible, we have seen the another, that is called as ultraviolet rays. So these are the different parts of or the components of this electromagnetic waves. We have seen some of the applications of these different types of electromagnetic waves. So as we are moving from larger wavelength to smaller wavelength, or smaller frequency to larger frequency, in this range or in this band, one more very important component of this electromagnetic radiation comes, and that is called as X-rays. So try to understand the location of X-ray. Okay, so it is in between, it is in between, okay, gamma rays and ultraviolet rays. Ultraviolet rays, we have already given its range, its frequencies and so on. So it has higher wavelength than gamma rays and lower wavelength than ultraviolet rays, whereas it has lower frequency than gamma rays and higher frequency than this ultraviolet rays. So frequency and wavelength of these X-rays lies in between the gamma rays and the ultraviolet rays. Now you are all familiar with this X-rays. The name of the X-rays is given by William Röntgen in 1895, because at that time no one was knew about this type of radiations. And later on, it was found that these radiations are generated by striking electrons or the photons on the metal plate, and some of the electrons in the interior of the atoms, these are removed. These locations or these vacancies are filled by outer electrons in that internal atoms, internal structure, and thereby X-rays are produced. So the production of X-rays and the production of visible rays is almost same, but in the visible radiations, the last electron in the orbit is responsible for production of this type of visible radiations. These electron absorb as well as these electron emits radiations, which are basically in the range of the visible radiations, that is around 300 to 700 nanometers. Whereas when an electron inside first orbit, second orbit, third orbit, etc. are removed or knocked out, and if these type of vacancies are filled by higher energy electrons or higher orbit electrons, in that case, whatever optical radiations or radiation, electromagnetic radiations emitted, these are called as these X-rays. Now, production of X-rays, how they are produced, how, what are their other properties, etc., that we can see later on from our textbook. But we are going to concentrate on these X-rays in detail. Now, you all know that X-rays has a very important application in medical physics. So some of the applications in medical physics we are going to mention here. So applications of X-rays in medical physics or medical science. Medical science applications. Let's name some of these applications known to us. So it is an integral part. X-ray is an integral part of modern hospitals and medical treatment. I think there is barely an hospital, allopathic hospital, which doesn't have this type of facility nowadays for diagnosis of simple operations or simple case. Okay, now for example, here it can X-rays, X-ray photography. Okay? So X-ray photographs can detect broken bones. Okay, whatever types of fractures we say, hairline fracture or major fracture, etc., these are picturized or these are photographs using this photo X-rays. X-rays can penetrate through your skin, they can go inside the body, and thereby they can picturize or picture the bones, human bones, very clearly, correctly, and thereby we can find out whatever fractures there, and according to further treatment can be followed. So this is one important application. Second, it can detect pneumonia. Okay, PNEU pneumonia, MONIA, pneumonia. The disease wherein the lungs of a person, lungs of a human or patient, get filled by that particular that is called as cuff. So whenever this cuff is filled inside the that particular lung of a particular person, then his inhalation or his respiration process may get hampered, and thereby oxygen level inside a human body goes on reducing whenever there occurs pneumonia. So how to detect this pneumonia? For that, you are supposed to expose to these X-ray photographs or X-ray films, X-ray radiations, and these radiations can film where are the locations where this pneumonia is occurring or has occurred, and accordingly further treatment can be done there. So correct estimation of pneumonia, how much amount, what extent these lungs are filled, what parts of these lungs are filled, etc., they can be detected by this X-ray. So in the detection of pneumonia, that is another important application or medical application. Then mammographs. Okay, so this is our mammograms. Mammograms. Now what are these mammograms? These are used to check breast cancers. So these mammograms are used to breast cancer, where these X-rays are used for the photography or for that particular filming of the things. This is important application. Then these X-rays are also used in cancer treatment. Because they have an ability to kill the malign tissues, or the tissues which are unwanted, the tissues which are generated without any reason, created any reason. So such type of tissues can be killed by focusing that particular part of body with this particular high energy X-ray radiations, and thereby in the treatment of cancer to certain extent these X-rays can be used here. Now how these applications are there? That is called as radiation treatment. Okay, that is called as radiation treatment. Not only X-rays, but the gamma rays are also used for that, but in some cases X-rays are also used, and that is one of the very important application of X-rays, where cancer treatment can be carried out with the help of these X-rays in some cases. Now actual in hospitals how these X-rays are used, etc., these things we are not interested here. At this stage we must understand these X-rays have this application. Note, over exposure of X-rays also not good. To certain extent, to small time, okay, very fraction of second, these X-rays are allowed to enter into your body. Otherwise, if a continuous exposure is there, and that's why you are not allowed, except patient and doctor, no one is allowed to enter in that X-ray room for any other reason. Okay, so because these X-rays may cause a damage, permanent damage into your body, and that may cause another problems in a body. That's why X-rays are harmful if it is taken as an overdose. So proper care has to be taken while taking this type of X-ray photographs of either bones or some malign object, like in cancer treatment or mammograms, or in case of detection of pneumonia. These proper doses of X-rays are needed, and that's why a technician is needed, experienced technician is needed to go for this type of processes and this type of treatments. So that's what we have to be very careful regarding this medical applications of these X-rays. Now second application we are going to do, that is another very important application in common life, everyday life, that is in X-rays are used in airport security. X-rays are used in airport security. I think some of you might have seen that. Nowadays these type of machines are applied at the railway stations too, or at some of the bus stations. You have to scan your luggage through this type of devices, and whenever if this luggage contains any explosive or any metal weapons, etc. These can be detected very easily using these X-ray radiations, and that is X-ray scanning. So these devices which are used at airport security, which are using these X-rays to identify hidden objects. To identify hidden objects. So this, maybe weapons, maybe explosives, maybe something other than that. So sometimes we hear this news. So some gold is captured at some of the airport or at some location. How people come to know this? In that case, when this particular type of luggages are scanned through these X-ray machines or X-ray scanner, then in that case, these type of metals can be very easily identified. So in the airport security, in the railway security, or wherever others, different locations, these type of X-ray scanners are applied, and that uses these X-ray radiations is another important case. And third and very important application of this is crystallography. Now what is this? This is actually science. I think you might have heard about this XRD. This is called as X-ray diffraction techniques. Now what are these X-ray diffraction techniques or methodology? That is used to find out the structures of the solid. So you might have seen there are several structures, crystal structures like NaCl. NaCl has this structure which we call as a simple cubic structure. So or some other type of substance also can be given. Now how to identify this structure? For that case, we have to apply this particular X-rays, and this particular objects are to be illuminated at this materials of which we are supposed to find out its crystal structure. And whenever this type of illumination takes place, these X-rays get diffracted. Now process of diffraction you might be knowing in optics. So such type of diffraction is carried out, and you measuring this diffraction or photographing this diffraction, to what extent diffraction occurs, in which direction that diffraction occurs, etc., we can generate certain pattern which are called as X-ray diffraction patterns. And from that diffraction, using certain mathematical treatment or mathematical methods, one can find out what is the structure of a given element or compound or whatever. So this type of crystal structures, simple cubic structure, body centered cubic structure, face centered cubic structure, hexagonal structure, etc., etc., all the materials or the compounds which are having this type of regular structures, crystals, so such structures can be determined using this X-ray spectroscopy. Now this is what called as X-ray diffraction. More about this we are going to see in detail when we go for the next chapter, that is chapter number 5. But before that, let me write few things about this. So this technique in this technique, X-rays are diffracted by regular crystals. If X-rays are diffracted in regular crystals, and what we can do this from diffraction pattern, various aspects. Aspects like grain size, structure, then atomic distance, or that is called as interplanar distance. There are several different planes, and there is one more thing that is called as Miller indices. That's very important part in solid state physics, etc., can be determined. And there is called as crystal structure is determined. This particular branch of physics is called as crystallography. Note that this has large applications in material science. So almost all crystals whether it is calcium carbonate, whether it is calcium chloride or sodium chloride or any other. You can name this particular crystal. Every crystal has its own diffraction pattern, and knowing this pattern, one can go for identification of this type of materials. So that is what in forensic science too, this type of crystallography plays a very, very vital role. Nowadays in modern physics, we are coming across several different types of new materials, and how to identify which materials have been created in a particular nuclear reaction or this type of chemical reactions. And in that case, this type of structure determination is possible with the possibility that is called as X-ray diffraction or XRD. Fortunately, in our college library, one such device is there, which is also, we are going to show this once again, whenever it is possible, we'll come across this type of X-ray diffraction technique, how these techniques are used. And actually in TYBSC, you are going to have one such experiment, how to carry out this X-ray diffraction and how to determine a structure or other types of constants for a given type of compound. And this type of practical things will be discussed there later on. But these days, this is one of the very important application of this. And some of you might have known that this particular X-ray diffraction technique was used by Watson and Crick to find out the structure of DNA. Okay, so DNA structure was determined by Watson and Crick, okay, around 1950 somewhere, maybe that, I don't know exact the date there, but this is what a beginning of this molecular biology. So biology, whatever different types of cells, molecules, DNA, RNA, etc., their structures, their other properties, their composition, etc., these things could be understood with the help of this X-ray spectroscopy. So try to understand, not only in material science or in physics, but in biology also, or in medical physics, this X-ray has a large number of applications. Remember, again, as I mentioned here, we can only mention some of the applications. Other than that, there are several other industrial applications too, but at this time we are not going to discuss there. Now in the next chapter, chapter number 5, we are going to concentrate on certain devices, fixed devices, for example microwave oven, X-ray diffraction, solar cell, etc. These type of devices we are going to see. These are the actual practical applications of this type of electromagnetic radiations. So here we have finished this now, X-rays and so on. And the last part of this we are going to discuss, that is called as gamma rays. Okay. So gamma, or sometimes you use this symbol, gamma rays. Remember, origin of gamma rays, again a nucleus. Origin is nucleus, or sometimes nuclear reactions, radioactivity and so on, different types of nuclear reactions. So origin of this is not now electrons, but the internal proton and neutron inside an atom, they change their energies, thereby this nucleus changes its energies, and this energy, or the amount of energy released in this case, is so high, its frequency is maximum. So these are the radiations having frequency maximum and wavelength is minimum. Okay, so in our spectrum, this is at the extreme end, left hand extreme, left extreme, and this particular thing is that they have minimum wavelength and maximum frequency, and these radiations are emitted in case of nucleus or different types of nuclear reactions. There are some other, I think you might have heard this name, something, some other, this is called as BRAME, STRHALUNG, BRAME strontium radiations. Okay, I just give this a small exercise. Just give this search in the Wikipedia or any other Google platform, Google site, BRAME strontium radiation or breaking radiation. So BRAME strontium is one of the very important source of generation of these X-rays, but not in naturally, it is natural, that means in laboratory we can produce these type of radiations, but most of the stars, galaxies, etc., extra galactic material is there, these type of objects emit radiations which are in the form of this BRAME strontium radiations. So actually we are not going to discuss much about this, but you can go for checking. This is the name, Brem Strahlen is the name of the scientist, and these radiations is one of the important source of radiation from stars like sun or galaxies or black holes and like these things. They also produce these X-rays, and that is what the method of generation of X-rays. There are no such devices, म्हणजे अशा कुठल्याही गॅलेक्सी मध्ये वगैरे असे डिव्हाइसेस कुठले नसतात. नैसर्गिकरित्या सुद्धा एक्सरेज तयार होतात आणि त्याची जी प्रोसेस असेल त्याला आपण ब्रेम स्ट्रॉलन रेडिएशन असं म्हणतो. सो गो फॉर सर्च ऑफ दिस ब्रेम स्ट्रॉलन रेडिएशन अँड गेट सम इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट दिस, बट दॅट इज नॉट ए कंपल्सरी ऍक्टिव्हिटी हियर. ओके, नाउ इन केस ऑफ गॅमा रेज, एज आई सेड, दिस गॅमा रेज अगेन बिट हार्मफुल, दे कॅन कॉज ए कॅन्सर. सो यू हॅव टू बी व्हेरी केअरफुल अबाउट दिस टाइप ऑफ गॅमा रेडिएशन सोर्सेस अँड ऑल दॅट हँडलिंग ऑफ दिस सोर्सेस. Then other storage of the sources, etc. There are some techniques are needed, some processes are there which are specified by scientists. So gamma ray source is not that to be a source as available everywhere. So you have to be very careful about this. Okay. Now this applications. What are the applications in cancer treatment? In cancer treatment, that is also called as radiation therapy. Radiation therapy, where a proper dose of gamma rays is given to a patient and the malign tissues, that is the tissues unwanted or cancerous tissues, can be killed with a very finite precision or accuracy, thereby other parts of the body doesn't get damaged. Only that type of tissues are the cancerous tissues can be killed, and thereby patient can be treated in such a case using these gamma radiations. And that's why this is one of the very important application of this gamma rays. Okay, X-rays also used for that, but gamma rays has a more important application or more dominant application as compared to this X-ray. So these gamma radiations can penetrate deep inside, whereas X-rays cannot penetrate deep inside. Only skin or 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters, 10 millimeters only, that is the penetration of X-rays. Because gamma rays can pass through entire body, and thereby they can be applied on a particular cells, particular small amount of cells, and these cells can be killed very accurately. So as compared to X-rays, gamma rays are more useful in the radiation therapy. That is one simple application we have to go. Second is that sometimes in medical surgery, this surgical knife, gamma rays are used as surgical knife, knife, okay, chaku sarka tyacha upyog karto, surgical knife in surgery we use this very small. Okay, how this treatment is there, we are not going to go for that. Then third application is of this gamma rays is measurement of soil density. This is again a commercial application, we won't go for into details of that. Fourth application can be listed here, packaging of foods. Okay, packaging, PACKAGE, packaging of foods and drugs. So packaging of foods and drugs, so whatever germs there, bacteria there, they can be directly killed, and shelf life of the substances or drugs can be increased. So shelf life can be increased. This is again a commercial application of this gamma rays. And one more application is, fifth is sterilizing of medical equipments. STERILIZING, sterilizing of medical equipments. So in medical laboratory, medical equipment, so sterilization is also tests can be carried out with this gamma rays. And other than that, other applications are there. So these are the few important applications of the gamma rays. Now let's look, we have gone for all different details of the electromagnetic spectrum, right from radio waves to gamma rays. And apart from that, we have in earlier discussions we have said something about the cosmic radiations or cosmic rays. Remember, cosmic rays actually is not a part of this electromagnetic radiations, but these are actual high energy particles which are emitted by star like sun or some other extragalactic object, black hole and all that. Whenever this supernova explosion occurs there, and lot many things are there in this universe, these type of things occur, and these type of processes that gives out a radiations which are called as cosmic radiations. And cosmic radiations is not actual part of this electromagnetic radiations, but whenever these type of radiations occur or do come in the atmosphere of the Earth, these radiations or cosmic radiations interact with the molecules and atoms of the air, of different types of air and air substances, and thereby they can cause a secondary emission, tertiary emission, fourth type emission, and a cascade of radiations are generated, elementary particles and radiations generated. But this is called as a cosmic rays, and cosmic rays plays a very vital and important role in the identification of different types of extragalactic objects, their properties, their other types of things also can be discussed. So actually it is not a part of this electromagnetic radiations, but we must know something about this cosmic rays and their applications too. Okay, that is what we are not going to write here. So that is how in general we have seen almost all different types of electromagnetic waves and their applications in little bit. We have not studied specific applications as what we have seen in case of microwave oven, how it works, what it, how it is constituted, what are its components, how it works, then what are its applications, etc. These type of things we are going to discuss exclusively in the next chapter after your internal examination. In the next week you are having an internal examination, and for that internal examination, as I said, you have to prepare whatever study we have done till today. So till today we have finished this chapter number 4 from this particular syllabus of physics paper 2, and I'm sure in physics 1 almost all chapters have been finished. So there will be numerical questions that will be asked in examination, MCQ, multiple choice questions that will be asked in the examination, and for that study your textbook, study the notes which you have been given. Already I have given assignments over all these chapters, whatever chapters I have taught in the paper 1 as well as paper 2, I'm giving the today exam assignment there. So this is what assignment number 1 on this chapter. Okay, assignment number 1. Now what is this assignment? I'll just give you this in writing, and later on I'll send the photograph or the snapshot of this. In our textbook, on the page number 4.25, all these applications of electromagnetic waves are given in tabulated form. If possible, read that particular table once. It is not a more than one page table. If possible, I'll send that page too. Then there are very simple numerical questions. All these numerical questions are based upon the formula C is equal to nu into lambda. So velocity of wave is equal to its frequency multiplied by its wavelength. This, using this relationship, simple problems have been asked. There are three four problems in the solved section and 6 problems in the unsolved section. We can go for all the problems there. Now in assignment number 1, first part is all MCQs, and second part here is true or false. State true or false. So this is your first assignment. Okay, that is given on page number 4.28 and 29. Page 4.28 and 4.29. Actually, its answers are also given there. But before going to answer, you try to solve these questions, MCQs, as well as these true and false statements, using your knowledge or using your study, and then you can compare with the correct answers, etc. Thereby some of the questions may be asked in the examination. This is assignment 1. And assignment 2, number 2 is here. First part is all short answer question. Short answer questions. And second part here is the long answer question and numerical. Long answer questions. And third part here is numerical questions. Okay, there are 6 questions only. Let's try to solve all 6. And all this you will find on page number 4.29. Page 4.29 and 4.30. Okay, so both of these pages I am going to send later on the WhatsApp group. You can check it, as well as I am going to post these on the LMS and from that also you can get this. But prepare these assignments too, these two assignments. So in all I have given four assignments, two assignments from chapter one, paper one on the properties of matter, and these are the two assignments on the chapter number four from the paper two. So this is from paper two, that was from paper one. Submit these assignments when you are asked. So at present you have to prepare these assignments, so that will help you to study this particular all the chapters and the subject, and that assignments will be given certain internal credits. So this every assignment is to be submitted, whatever the date or the format you have been given, either you can submit it online or offline, but still the things are not yet settled. So as and when it is settled, I'll tell you in what format you have to submit all these your assignments. So but be prepared, these assignments, they will carry some internal score almost of 50 marks. 50 marks is external examination, 50 marks is internal examination, and this internal scoring will be based upon these type of assignments. So almost all questions will be covered in both of these assignment from the chapter number 4 from paper 2. Okay, so today we have finished this chapter number 4, and after you finish your internal examination in the next week, next week we are going to start chapter number 5, that is the applications of electromagnetic waves again, but specific applications, as I said, like several different types of devices, several different types of techniques that are used in physics, like X-ray diffraction, then solar cells, how solar cell work, what is its constituents, how it is efficiency is measured, its applications, its modifications, etc. These type of technical things we are going to learn one by one in the next 4-5 lectures, when we will go for the chapter number 5. Okay, apart from that, you have to prepare for the internal examination, as I said. So in spite of going for other things here, we will just stop here today. Before that, I have to give certain instructions. Don't leave.